Okay, good evening, everyone. So, last week we studied some basic conceptions of probability. So, first, what is probability? So, one interpretation of probability is that it can be understood as a long or relative frequency, right? So we use the example of flipping a coin. So we flip a coin many, many times. And because the coin is symmetric and the mass of that is distributed evenly everywhere, right? So we would expect that the proportion of heads should be, cannot be smaller or bigger than the fraction of tails, right? So because of this, you would expect that if you flip it many, many times, then the relative frequency should be close to one half. So that's the longer relative frequency of heads. So this longer relative frequency is called probability. And this is, as I said, this is one interpretation of probability. And actually, if you check some books or just Wikipedia, you could find that there are other interpretations of probability. So if you're interested, I think I would suggest you go through Wikipedia and you could find interesting stories there. But as I said, so this long-run relative frequency interpretation is just a motivation of probability. It is not the rigorous mathematical definition of probability. So what would be the rigorous definition? So what do we really start with is this probability space, the construction of probability space. That is our real starting point of this course. Right, so as I said, longer relative frequency stuff is just an interpretation or motivation. And based on this interpretation, we need to derive a set of properties and formulate a mathematical framework, so which is this probability space. And this is really our starting point. And with the longer relative frequency stuff, you can think that as a advertiser of this course. And this is the start of the mandate. So maybe let's have a quick review of this probability space. So before that, maybe let me remind you of several important conceptions. So the first thing is the sample space. What is the sample space? So we need to perform an experiment. The outcome of this experiment is unknown, right? So, which is used to model uncertainty. And the set of all possible outcomes of this random experiment is called the sample space. So, everything here is called sample space. And we're usually interested in the probability of events. What is an event? Event is just a subset of the sample space or a set of outcomes. As I explained last week, because we wish to have more flexibilities when we use probability, then it's more convenient for us to study the probability of an event rather than individual outcomes, right? So we have a sample space, we have events, then we are ready to define the sample space, the probability space. So the probability space consists of three guys. The first one is sample space, the set of all possible outcomes. And the second guy is the collection of events. So we are interested in the probability of events, right? The third guy is the so-called probability, so which is the rule to assign numbers between 0 and 1 to events, right? And so this probability needs to satisfy three conditions. So the first condition is that the probability of the simple space must be equal to 1, and the probability of any event must be bigger or equal to 0. And the third condition is so-called countable additivity. So which means that if we have a sequence of pairwise disjoint events, then the probability of their union should be equal to the sum of their respective probabilities. So actually, these three conditions sometimes are called Kolmogorov's three axioms for probability. Why it has such a name? Because let me give you some historical remark. For a long, long time, probability theory was not considered as a branch of mathematics. So why is so? Because so its foundation was a bit shaky. So I introduced that long relative frequency interpretation. At the beginning, people wished to use that as the foundation to build up a mathematical theory. But because that interpretation may not be very neat, because there's a limits involved, right? So then if you wish to build up a theory upon it, then things could become very messy. And because of this, this reason, then for centuries, then people had difficult time to derive a series, rigorous series for probability. Until I think in the 1930s, so the great Russian mathematician Kolmogorov found out that actually probability is indeed a special kind of the so-called measure. Measure is a conception in mathematical analysis. Because he realized that it's a measure, then he just borrowed some conception from measure theory and devised this conception of probability space. And it turns out that based on this definition, things become much neater and cleaner. And it is possible to just use some basic results from measure theory to establish the entire foundation of probability theory. And because of this reason, so nowadays, so this conception of probability space is regarded as the starting point of probability theory. And Kolmogorov is also considered as the founding father of modern probability theory. So that's some historical remarks. Last week we also introduced some useful properties of probability. So for example, the probability of the empty set must be equal to 0. And if we have finitely many disjoint events, then the probability of the union should be equal to the sum of their respective probabilities. And also, the probability of a complement of the event should be equal to 1 minus the probability of that event. So also, probability of an event must be less than or equal to 1. And this is how to calculate the probability of the union of two events, and so on, right? So such results are very fundamental, and you must be familiar with these results. think before we finish last week, we discussed this example. So what is that? So maybe let's have a very quick review. So we collate the die. So this die is a fair die. So which means that the outcome could be 1 up to 6 with probability 1/6 for each, right? And then the rule of the game is like this. So if the outcome is either 1 or 3, you win. Otherwise, you lose, right? So then you're interested in the event of A, which is defined to be the event consisting of 1 and 3. And because you have the sample space has 6 outcomes, then the probability that you win would be 2 over 6, so which is 1/3, right? And then suppose that at one day, the die was flipped, but before you can see the outcome, then someone else saw it first, and you were told that the outcome is odd, right? So because the outcome is odd, so which means that so even if you don't know the outcome, but at least you know that it must be among 1, 3, and 5, because it's odd, right? And in this very simple example, you can see that after you know an extra piece of information, so essentially, so your sample space has shrinked. So after you know this piece of information, so outcomes such as 2, 4, 6 can be excluded, right? So in this case, the probability that you win will be changed. So previously, before you know any information, the chance is 1/3. And now it should be 2 outcomes out of 3 outcomes, which is 2/3, right? So by this very simple example, you can see that so this extra information can change the probability. Before you know this information, the probability is called unconditional probability. After you know this information, it becomes conditional information, right? So why this condition can change the probability? Because so this condition can rule out certain outcomes so that your effective sample space will be changed, right? So generally speaking, if you know certain information, then the probability will change accordingly. So because of this, we can introduce some very important notion called conditional probability. So what is the idea? So the idea is just like this. So suppose we have two events, A and B, right? So suppose that you're interested in the probability that A occurs. So then before you know the outcome, you know that you get a piece of information which says that B has occurred, right? After knowing this, so actually, before you know this, the outcome could be anyone within the sample space. But after you know this, then the outcome can only be within event B, right? So in this case, if you're still interested in the probability that A occurs, because the outcome must be in B, so if it's also in A, it must be in the intersection of A and B. So that's the idea. So after you know the condition, then so the probability must be within the outcome must be within the A and at the intersection of A and B, right? And now, so the conditional probability, so based on this observation, the conditional probability is defined in this way. So the conditional probability of A given B is simply defined as the probability of the intersection over the probability of B. So why is so? Because you can just think of it as a line diagram. So previously, before you know the condition, you wish to know the probability of A, so which can be regarded as the fraction of the area of A over this entire rectangle, because this rectangle is the sample space, right? After you know that, the outcome must be within B, so the for you, the sample space has shrunk from the central omega to B, right? If you are still interested in the probability that A occurs, then essentially you will be interested in the probability that the outcome within both A and B, right? So then the probability will be changed into the area of the intersection over the area of B. So that's the basic idea of conditional probability, right? And as we discussed in a previous example, after you know that the outcome is odd, then the probability that you win will change from one-third to two-thirds. So this is a conditional probability. So maybe we can discuss another very simple example. So this example is like this. This time we flip a fair coin twice. So because we flip it twice, the sample space has four outcomes. It could be heads, heads, tails, tails, heads, tails, tails, right? And then let's consider two events. A would be the first flip is heads. The first flip is heads means the second one could be either heads or tails. So this event has two outcomes, HH or HT. And B, event B is the event that the second flip is heads. So which is HH and TH, right? So we wish to know the probability of A given B. A given B means that you know the second flip is heads. What is the flip that what is the probability that the first flip is also heads? So how to calculate that? We just use the definition of conditional probability, right? So it is just the probability of intersection of those two events over the probability of the condition. So A intersects B, A has two outcomes, B has two outcomes. The intersection of them is just HH, right? Both the first flip and the second flip are heads. So this is the numerator. Denominator is just two outcomes out of four outcomes, right? So you see the probability is just one quarter over one half, which is also one half. So this is pretty straightforward. But maybe we can think of this example a bit more. So we know that, so we're interested in the probability that the first flip is heads, right? So before we know any condition, what is the unconditional probability of this event? It is just two outcomes over four outcomes, right? Because so you have two outcomes in this event A, two over four, which is one half. And this after that, so we calculate the conditional probability. You know that the second flip is heads, and you know the probability that the first flip is also heads. What is this conditional probability? So we know that it is one half, right? Then you see something interesting, because in the previous example, our probability would be changed from one-third to two-thirds. But in this example, the probability doesn't change, right? After you know that B occurs, it doesn't change the probability that A occurs, right? So what does it mean? Actually, In this example, it shows that not all information would be useful. What would you mean useful, right? So not all information would change the probability. At least in this example, even if you know that the second flip is has, it doesn't change the probability that the first flip is has, right? So, but if you think of this example more carefully, you'd see that it makes sense. Because what is this random experiment? You just flip a coin twice, right? So the outcome of those two flips actually should have nothing to do with each other. So no matter what is the result of your first flip, it won't change. It won't affect the result of the second flip, right? So in this way, you can see that at least here, you know some extra information. So this information can definitely help you to exclude certain outcomes. It can help you to shrink the sample space, but it will not really change the probability. The unconditional probability and the conditional probability will be the same. Or in other words, so this means that those two events have nothing to do with each other, right? I think this is just a very intuitive observation, and later I will come back to this example when we discuss independence. But maybe let's push this example aside, and we just move on to the next exercise example for you to better understand conditional probability. So this example is like this. So suppose that we have a bin of transistors. So transistor is just a small electronic device. So suppose that we have totally 30 transistors. So among them, 5 are defective. Defective means that if we put it in use, it will fail immediately. And 10 are partially defective. Partially defective means that, so if you use it, then it will fail after some time. And the remaining 25 are good ones, so they're acceptable resistors. So within this bin, suppose that we choose one transistor at random. At random means equally likely. We have totally 40 transistors, so the chance that we'll pick any one of them will be 1 over 40. So then we pick one at random, and we put it into use. So suppose that it does not fail immediately. Then the question is, what is the probability that it is acceptable? Right? So this is this example, I think it's pretty simple for most of you. Maybe I just go over the solution. So the solution is just like this. So here, maybe let's first define several events because we wish to analyze probability, right? So maybe we can use capital D for the event that the selected transducer is defective, D for defective, and P for partially defective, right? And this A for acceptable. So we can see that, so those three events are destroyed. So they have no common outcomes. So then, what is the probability that the randomly picked one is acceptable? So we have totally 25 acceptable transistors among 40 transistors. So because I would pick them at random, so the chance would be 25 over 40, right? That's 5 over 8. But this is the unconditional probability. But we know that some condition here. So the condition is that we put this transistor in use and it did not fail immediately. It did not fail immediately means that it's either acceptable or partially defective, right? So you can see, so it did not fail immediately, so it must be within the complement of event B, right? So it's either within P or within A. So it's within this yellow area, right? Yellow region. So then let's see how to calculate the conditional probability. Because it did not fail immediately, so we know that the outcome must be within the D complement. So in other words, it must be within this yellow region. So the conditional probability of this acceptable transistor, this transistor is acceptable given that so it did not fail immediately. So by definition, would be the probability of the intersection over the probability of the condition, right? So according to this Venn diagram, we can see that so the intersection of A and the D complement is simply A, because A is a subset of D complement. So the numerator is just here, and the denominator is just event, the union of P and A, the two events, right? So the probability of A, so as we discussed, is just 25 out of 40. And the probability of the complement would be 35 out of 40, because we know that there are only 5 defective transistors. So in this case, you can see that so this conditional probability is just 25 over 35. So this is a very simple example. It's, I think, it's also here. The next. From the definition of conditional probability, actually, it is so there's a very simple but useful result called a multiplication rule. What is that? So this result just says that if you wish to calculate the probability of the intersection of two events, A and B, it can be calculated in this way. It is equal to the conditional probability of A given B times the probability of B. So how to prove that? Actually, it's very simple, because if you check the definition of conditional probability, right? So conditional probability is defined in this way, and if you wish to know the probability of the intersection of A and B, of course, it is equal to conditional probability times the probability of the condition, right? So it's just a straightforward consequence of the definition of conditional probability. So, but and this result, this very, very simple result, has a good name called multiplication rule. So maybe let's think of a simple exercise to better understand this multiplication rule. So let's think of an example like this. So suppose that there's a lady called Miss Lee, and she figures out that, so there is a 30% chance that her company will set up a branch office in Singapore. So if it happens, so then 60% chance she will be the manager of this branch. Then the question is, what is the probability that she will be so this a manager of the Singapore branch office? So, as I said, when we study, when we wish to calculate certain probability, I think it would be a good habit to first write down all the related events and write down the related probabilities and the conditional probabilities. So, so before we solve a problem, no matter how simple or how difficult it would be, so let's first organize things in a neat and clean way. And actually, in this example, there are two events involved. Maybe we can call the first event A, so which means that so this lady will be the manager. And the second event, we call it B, so which means that the company will have a branch in Singapore, right? So then let's discuss what we know about those two events, right? So first, we know that with 30% of chance, the company will set up that office, that branch. And so if there is such a branch, so if there is such a branch, which is a condition, right? So which means that B happens. If B happens, then with 60% of chance, the lady would be the manager. So probability of A given B is 60%, so that's the conditional probability. And here, what we really wish to know is that what is the probability of A, right? So that's highlight the question in blue. So how to calculate that? And so if we think of so the probability of A, so which means that the lady will be the manager, then we can easily realize that only when so there will be a such office, then she will be the manager, right? So, which means that event B is like a prerequisite of event A. So in other words, if A happens, B must have happened. So in other words, so if you think of this as a random experiment, if A happens or A occurs, means the outcome is in A, then B must occur. What does it mean? It means that A must be a subset of B, right? If, A happens, B must happen. It means that A must be a subset of B. And because of this, so if we wish to know the probability of A, then essentially, it is the probability of A intersecting B. What is the probability of A intersecting B? So we can use the multiplication rule. So it's just a conditional probability of A given B times the probability of B, right? So the solution could be pretty simple. It's just the product of the two numbers we know, right? So this is a very simple example, but I think if you're a beginner for probability, at least, I think not, at least not all of you will understand this in a very clear way, even if it's, it seems very simple, because it involves something like this A is a subset of B, if this occurs, that occur, or something, right? So, actually, my real purpose for this very simple exercise example is that I wish to use an example to introduce a very useful tool for calculating probabilities. So this tool is called tree diagram. So now let's see how to analyze this problem by using this tree diagram. So here, as you can see, next we'll introduce this tree diagram. So what is a tree diagram? It is a tool for analyzing conditional probabilities. I mean, not just conditional probabilities. So what would be the basic idea of the tree diagram? Actually, it's pretty straightforward. Because there are different events involved, right? So we just consider what will happen if this event occurs. What will happen if this event does not occur? And then we just analyze each event to see if A occurs, B does not occur, what's going on. If A does not occur, B occurs, what's going on. So the basic idea is just like we discussed all possible cases. So because there are multiple events involved, then eventually when you analyze different events at different levels, you will form a tree, right? Just like what do you see here, right? So then let's see how to create a tree diagram. So for this problem, so we can draw a tree diagram like this. So the tree diagram will begin with a root node, so which is just the red dot here. So it is called a root node. So this root node stands for the entire sample space. It's the beginning point, and the outcome could be anything within the sample space. Everything is possible, right? So then we know that, so we have some extra information columns, right? So for example, for this problem, we know that, so there's an event called B. So let's recall, what is this event B? B means the company will have a branch in Singapore. And we also know that, so the probability of B is 30%, right? So then, let's consider case by case. So the first case is that, suppose that B occurs. B occurs means that the company will set up the branch, right? With probability 30%. According to this, we will draw a branch for this tree. So this is this branch. And over this branch, we put the probability there. So again, so over this branch, it means that B occurs. B occurs with probability 30%. So it is this branch. And then we move to the next node. So the next node would be the dot in blue color. So for that blue node, it means that B already occurred. B has occurred, right? So then, from this node, let's consider what will happen if event A occurs. So what is event A? Event A means the lady will be the manager, right? So about this event, we know that there's a conditional probability. So because this node, this blue node, B already occurs, then any probability after this node would be a conditional probability. Condition on B has occurred, right? So then such a probability would be, so this guy, if there is a cyclical branch and the lady will be the manager with probability 60%. So we put that conditional probability there. And now, so we have a further branch, right? And the end of the branch is this the node, this green node. So for this green node, we know that here, at this node, both A and B have occurred. So then both A and B have occurred, which means that at this node, their intersection occurs, right? What is the probability of the intersection? We just use a multiplication rule. So the probability of A intersect B is just the probability of B times the conditional probability of A given B. So this number, 0.3 times 0.6, right? You reach this node, you just calculate, the probability at this node is just multiply the numbers along the branch until from the root node until this node, right? So this guy, you go from this red point to this green point, then over this branch you have 0.3, over this branch you have 0.6. So 0.3 times 0.6, so that's 0.18. So that is the probability here. And also, from this blue node, it is also possible that the lady will not be the manager, right? So the lady will not be the manager means that a complement occurs. A does not occur where a complement occurs, right? So what is the probability that a complement given B? So because the outcome is already in B from this node, right? Then if it's not in A, it must be in a complement. Because of this, you can easily see that so this probability, the probability of A complement given B must be equal to 1 minus the probability of A given B, right? In other words, so this number plus this number must be equal to 1. So as you can see from here, so if this guy is 0.6, then this guy must be 0.4, right? And then, so we reach, so this node. So this node, what is the probability at this node? At this node, which means that both B and A complement have occurred. Then the probability of their intersection is just, so this 0.3 times, so this 0.4, right? We just go from this red dot to this blue dot, and then to this this dot. So that's the probability. And also, we can discuss other cases, right? So it is also possible that from this root node, B does not occur. B does not occur means B complement occurs. So if probability of B is 0.3, the probability of B complement must be equal to 1 minus 0.3, which is 0.7, right? And then we have a new node here. And similarly, so this node means B complement occurs, or B does not occur, right? So from this node, then B complement has occurred. Then we can think of whether A occurs or not, right? So here, so what is the probability of A given B complement? So in this problem, again, B complement means there will be no singleton branch, right? If no branch, no manager. There's no way for the lady to become the manager. So you can see that if no branch, so the probability of A would become zero, right? So this is the conditional probability. And so here, so after we consider the event A, then we reach to this node. So this node is A intersect B complement. So what is the probability? Just 0.7 times 0, which is 0, right? And then, so there's another case we need to discuss, so which is also from so this node, which is B complement occurs. If B complement occurs, but A on the A complement occurs, so then, so we will have this node, right? What is the conditional probability of A complement given B complement? B complement means no branch. A complement means the lady is not the manager. No branch, no manager, right? So which just must be equal to 1. And you've got this probability. So from here, you can see that if we consider two events, then it is possible that we have four different cases. And by using this tree diagram, so we can calculate the probability of each of those four cases, right? So it's a very clear and convenient way. So now, actually, in this problem, so what we really wish to know is the probability of A. So what is the probability of A? So here, we wish to know the probability of A, then we can just check those four cases, right? So the first case is the probability of A intersect B. And the third case is the probability of A intersect B complement. So we wish to know the probability of A, and A appears here and here. I colored those two cases blue, right? So if we wish to know the probability of A, actually, it is just the sum of the probability of this case and this case, those two blue cases. Why is so? Because both A are involved, and also we can see that because the first one is A intersect B, the second one is A intersect B complement, the disjoint, right? And the union of them is exactly A. So if you wish to know the probability of A, you just need to consider this case and this case, add them together, so which is 0.18, right? So you can see, so this is a very clear way to organize all possible cases there, to analyze all possible cases, right? And actually, maybe for you to better understand, so this tree diagram, maybe I can also draw a Venn diagram, so like this. So here, again, so this big rectangle is the sample space, right? And first, so we need to consider event B, whether it occurs or not, right? So suppose that, so this this B is just the event on the right-hand side, right? So on the right-hand side is the event B, and so the B complement would be on the left-hand side, right? So their union is the sample space, and they're disjoint, right? And we have another event A. So which is just this blue region, right? Which is event A. And you can see that, so because we need to consider both A and B, so this event A can be divided into two parts. The first part is on the right-hand side, which is the union of A and B, which is the intersection of A and B. And the second part of that is on the left-hand side, which is intersection of A and B complement, right? If you put them together, you'll get A. And those two parts are disjoint, right? So, essentially, what we did for the tree diagram, we just consider so all the four parts of the sample space, right? We just consider what is the probability of each part. And if we wish to know the probability of A, we just put the two blue parts together, and we add the corresponding probabilities, then we have the probability of A. So this is a very simple idea. Before we move on, any questions? I think so. If you can also, if you don't wish to ask me questions openly, you can also log in the Zoom session using your phone and send me a message here, so it'll be popped up here. Let's go back to our slides, and the tree diagram is here. And so here I use this A prime for complements because I draw the picture using a PowerPoint, and I don't know how to try to put the letter C there, so I just use a prime instead. So there's another result called law of total probability. What is that? Actually, this is just the thing we discussed just now. But this time, maybe we consider a more general case. So what we just discussed is just first to draw a rectangle for the sample space, right? Then we have event B, we have event A. So then by considering those two events, the entire sample space is divided into four parts, right? Actually, this idea can be generalized so like this. So if we check this this picture, so you see that this picture, actually the sample space, so which is this rectangle, is divided into four parts, four disjoint parts. We call them A1, A2, A3, A4, right? So then there's another event B, so which is this the circle, right? So because the entire sample space is divided into four disjoint parts, accordingly, so this event B is also divided into four disjoint parts. So each part is just an intersection of B with A1, A2, A3, and so on, right? So for example, so if you check, so this small part of B, which is the intersection of A1 and B. And so this is a pretty straightforward, right? And what is the law of total probability? It just says something like this. If you wish to calculate the probability of B, it can be calculated in such a way. What is this? So for example, if we check the first term on the right-hand side, so which is probability of B given A1 times the probability of A1. Then you can use the multiplication rule. The multiplication rule says that, so this guy, what is this guy? This guy actually is just the probability of A1 in the sector B, right? It is just this one. In other words, it's the probability of that part. So now we just do this. So in the same way, we consider the probability of each small part of B. So this part, because each part is just an intersection, we can use the metaprobation rule to use the product of the conditional probability and the probability of the condition to represent that. And then we put them together, and such result is called law of total probability. And as I said, the basic idea is just like what we discussed just now. So it's just like that. So this is a pretty simple, pretty straightforward result. To better understand this, maybe let's see another example, also very simple. So this example is like this. So suppose that there is an insurance company, and this company divided customers into two classes. So the first class is called accident prone. So, and the second class is called non-accident prone. Accident prone means so this type of people would be likely to make accidents, right? So they're dangerous people. So the statistics show that an accident-prone person will have an accident within next year with probability 30%. And for non-accident-prone people, the chance will be reduced to 20%. Right? So suppose that if we assume 30% of people are accident-prone, the question is, what is the probability that a new policyholder will have an accident within next year, right? So let's go over the solution of that. So again, so before we solve this problem, so let's first write down related events and put related probabilities there, right? It will help us to organize information we know. So then we have two events in this example. Maybe we call the first event A, so which means that a policyholder is accident prone. Right, and we know that 30% of people are accident prone, and we're interested in the event B, which is defined as the policyholder will have an accident next year. Right, so what do we know about this event? So we don't know the probability. That's the question, right? But we know certain conditional probabilities about this event. So we know that if a person is accident prone, then the 40% of probability he will have accident. If this guy is not accident prone, then 20% probability. So essentially, what we have is two conditional probabilities, right? The probability that B given A is 40%. B given A complement will be 10%. So A means, so this guy is accident prone. So A complement means this guy is non-accident prone, right? So here we wish to know what is the probability of B. So of course you can you can use the formula we just introduced, which is the law of total probability. But I would say a more convenient and the easier way is, again, to draw a tree diagram. So we just analyze all possible cases, and then you'll have a very good understanding. So let's see how to do that. So first, we begin with the root node. Again, it means the sample space. Everything is possible, right? And then, based on whether, so this guy is accident or proven, then, so this, from this root node, we have two branches. Over the first branch means A occurs, or this guy is accident prone. So the second branch means that this guy is not accident prone. So over the first branch, so we reach so this node. So again, this node means A already occurred, right? Then from this node, let's consider whether B occurs or not. If B occurs, because A already occurs, then the probability would be a conditional probability. Conditional probability of B given A, right? A means this guy is accident prone, so this conditional probability is just 40%. If he is accident prone, then with 40% of chance, he will have accident, so which is this branch. And then at the end of this branch, we draw another node. This node means both A and B occur. What is the probability? The probability is just the product, right? 0.3, 0.4, which is a 0.12. And then let's see another case. So if A already occurs, it's possible that so this guy would not have accident. So because this person is accident prone, because we're from this node, right? The probability that it will not have an accident is just 1 minus 0.4, which is 0.6, right? But then at the end of this branch, so the probability would be 0.3 times 0.6, which is 0.18. So this is this case. And also, we can discuss the second branch from the root node. Second branch means so this person is non-accident prone, so with probability of 70%. If this guy is not accident prone, then the chance that it will make an accident is 20%, right? So the probability is here. And we can also discuss the last case, which is the probability is 0.7 times 0.8, so it's like this, right? And in this problem, we wish to know the probability of B, right? And based on those two events, A and B, we already discussed all four cases, right? So let's see, among those four cases, where is B? Of course, B is here. B is in the event A intersects B. It is also in the event a complement intersect to B, right? So I just highlight those two cases in yellow. Then if we wish to know the probability of B, we just need to add those two numbers together, 0.5 plus 0.14, which is 0.26, right? So two possible cases, add them together. But actually, from this analysis of the tree diagram, you can see that the idea is just the same as the law of total probabilities, right? Just like when we explain the law of total probability, we use a line diagram like this, but using the tree diagram, so each small part has become a node, right? Node after two branches. But the idea will be just the same. So, which means that as long as you can use the tree diagram very well, you don't need to memorize things like this, right? Because they're the same thing. So this is the law of total probability. And the true diagram is here. And another very useful result is the so-called Bayes formula. So what is this Bayes formula? So this Bayes formula, the statement is like this. So again, we consider something like this. We have a bunch of events, A1, A2, up to AK, and those events are disjoint, and the union of them is the entire sample space. In other words, first we divide the sample space into K disjoint events, A1 up to AK, right? And the sighting will be the same as this one. So we wish to know a conditional probability like this. So we wish to know on the left-hand side, you see it's a conditional probability of AJ given B, right? So it's a conditional probability. How to calculate that? The definition will be the, just like this, the probability of intersection over the probability of B, right? So then, what is the numerator? Numerator is the probability of intersection. Then we can use the multiplication rule. It is equal to, so the probability of B given AJ times the probability of AJ, right? So you can easily see that this guy is equal to this guy, right? And then what is the denominator, probability of B? So we can just use the law of total probabilities. We just use this result, right? The probability of B is written in this form. And then we put it into the denominator. So we have something like this, right? And this thing is called Bayes formula. So you see, what is this Bayes formula? It's just a combination of total probability, multiplication rule, and law of total probability, right? So then, you may ask me the question, why bother to do this, right? At the left-hand side, it is something that looks very neat. It is just a conditional probability. But on the right-hand side, you give me a bunch of stuff, right? Why bother to do this? Because sometimes, so if you wish to calculate this conditional probability, it may not be convenient for you to derive the probability of the condition directly. You need to discuss. So if this happens, so what is the probability that B occurs? If that happens, what would be the probability that B occurs? So, actually, this Bayes formula just gives you the way that you can discuss case by case, right? So that's I think that's the idea of Bayes formula. But again, if you need to discuss case by case, I think you don't have to memorize such a complicated formula. You just need to draw a tree diagram, because all possible cases are there, right? So maybe I can give you another example. So then, so this example, of course, can be solved by using the Bayes formula directly, but I still prefer to use a tree diagram, because I think a tree diagram is neater and cleaner. So the problem is like this. So suppose that a plane is missing. And it is possible that, is he in any of three possible regions? So with equal probability. So with one third as in region one, one third in region two, one third in region three, and so on. Right? And let this one minus alpha I be the probability that the plane will be found upon the search of the ith region when the plane is in fact in that region. So this sentence is a bit long and it may not be easy to understand. So maybe let's think about this sentence again. So see that there's a condition. The condition is that when the plane is in fact in that region. So the condition is that the plane is in region I, right? The plane is in region I. In this case, so you search region I, the probability that, so you can find the plane is 1 minus alpha I. It's in region I, you search it with this probability, you will find it. So that's the meaning of this the sentence. And then the question is, what is the conditional probability that the plane is in the ith region, given that a search of region 1 is unsuccessful? So what does it mean? It means that actually we can think of the scenario. So the plane is gone. So we wish to find out the wreck. So we need to search three regions one by one, right? So suppose that we already searched region one, but we did not find anything. Then after this search, of course, we have some new information. So we wish to know that what is the chance the plane is in region 1, region 2, and region 3. So that's the question. So I think maybe before I give you the solution, we can have a short break of 10 minutes. After the break, I will discuss the solution to that. Okay. Okay. Let's move on. So so let's come back to this this example. So this example of the plane crash. So actually, I used this example quite several times when I taught this course. I copied this this example from textbook. I cannot remember so which textbook. So I thought it is just an example. Several days ago, actually, I saw a video at YouTube. So that video talked about a plane crash in Europe in 1960s. I think it's 1960s. I cannot remember clearly. So the plane was from the U.S. And actually, the plane was a bomber. And that plane carried nuclear weapons. And because of this, Americans were very, very eager to find out the plane wreck because it was in Europe. It must find it before the Soviet Union found it. So it's crucial. So what did those Americans did? Actually, they just searching each region. And after searching to this region, they just use the Bayes formula to update the probability. And then he would search the next most possible region for this plane. So in this way, they successfully found out the nuclear weapon before Soviet Union. So actually, this shows that this formula is useful. Right? So again, let's come back to this example. And so we have three regions, and the probability that the plane is in each region is just 1/3. And if the plane is in region I, then the probability that you search region I and find the plane would be 1 - i, right? So that's the the information we know. And so suppose that we already have an unsuccessful search of region one. Then we would like to know the conditional probability that the plane is in region one, region two, region three, and so on, right? So this is the question. And let's see the how to solve that. So again, just we just use a tree diagram. And first, let's put down events we know and put down related probabilities. So we can use this Ri for the event that the plane is in region I, right? R for region I. And we use Ei for unsuccessful search of region I. But here, we only consider E1 because we only know that we have unsuccessful search of region 1, right? So E1. For the probability, we know that probability of R1, R2, R3 will be 1/3. And also, if the plane is in region I, then so a successful reach of that will be, will have a probability 1 - i, right? Successful search would be the complement of unsuccessful search. So this probability would be probability of the EI complement given RI, right? So this is what we know. And also, because we know this probability, then we can derive the probability of the unsuccessful search given that so the plane is in region I, right? It is simply 1 - so this given probability, which is of I. So this is what we know from now. And the question is, what is the probability that after unsuccessful search of region 1, the plane is in region 1, region 2, region 3, right? So it's the probability of Ri given E1. So again, let's draw a tree diagram. So the plane crashed. It could be in region 1, region 2, region 3. Three different cases, right? So from the root node, we draw three branches. The first branch for R1, right? With probability 1/3. So then, if the plane is in region 1, now we reach so the second level. So we start from this node. From this node, we need to discuss whether E1 occurs or not, right? So E1 means an unsuccessful search of region 1. So if the plane is in region 1, the search is unsuccessful would be alpha 1, right? We just discussed that. And so in this case, so at this node, we have probability 1/3 times alpha 1, which is alpha 1 over 3. So what does it mean? It means, so the plane is in region one. We search this region and found it. So that's the probability, right? The probability is alpha 1 over 3. And it is also possible that it's in region 1, but we cannot find it, right? I'm sorry. So this is an unsuccessful search, which means that the play-in is in region 1. We searched region 1, but did not find it. So that's the first case. And it is possible that we search, it's in region 1, and we search it and find it. So the probability would be 1 minus alpha 1 over 3. So 1/3 times this probability. That's the second case. And then, let's go back to the root node. The second branch from that means the plane is in region 2, right? With probability 1/3. Then, at this node, we still need to consider E1, right? Because E1 is the event already occurred. So, if the play-in in region 2, what is the probability that we have an unsuccessful search in region 1? Because it is in region 2, right? You search region 1. There's no way that you find a plane. So which means that the search must be unsuccessful. In this way, so you can see that this conditional probability, the probability of E1 given R2 must be equal to 1, right? And then, so we have a third case. The probability of that is just 1/3 times 1, which is 1/3. So, what does it mean? It means that the plane is in region 2, so we search region 1, but unsuccessful. The probability will be 1/3, right? And we consider the fourth case. So, over this branch, it means that E1 complement occurs. E1 complement means a successful search in region 1, right? Given that the plane is in region 2, so the chance that you have successful search in region 1 would be 0. That's not possible, right? So this conditional probability would be 0. So for region 3, I think the case would be exactly the same as in region 2. So those numbers will be the same. And here, the question is, what is the probability of R1, R2, R3 given E1, right? So let's calculate them one by one. So first, let's calculate so this probability. So the probability of given an unsuccessful search in region 1, what is the probability that the plane is in region 1? So, for this one, by the definition of conditional probability, it should be the probability of intersection over the probability of condition, right? So, what is the numerator? Numerator is the probability of R1 intersecting E1. It is this guy, right? The first probability that colored in blue. So, it is the numerator, right? In the denominator, we wish to know the probability of E1. How to calculate that? We just consider, you know, we just collect all terms with E1, right? It's here, it's also here and here. Just those numbers colored in blue, right? So we add them together, and we have the probability of E1. So what is that? It's a law of total probabilities, right? So in the numerator, how do we got this? So this number times this number. That's the multiplication rule. Using the multiplication rule, we have a numerator. And we collect them together, and using the law of total probability, we derive the denominator. So that's exactly the same as Bayes' formula, right? So you see in this way, so we can have this probability. What is that? It's alpha 1 over alpha 1 plus 2, right? So if we wish to know the other two probabilities, we just do the same thing, right? So for example, if we wish to know the probability, so this enumerator, so which is the intersection of R2 and E1, so where is it? It is R2 and E1, it is here, right? So we just put the second blue guy in the numerator. The denominator will be the same as the previous one. So then, so this probability is 1 over alpha 1 plus 2, which is the probability that, so the plane is in region 2. And for the probability that is in region 3, will be the same as the previous case. So this way, we got all of the three conditional probabilities. And also, so as I explained, so essentially, the Bayes formula has been derived by so this procedure, right? You see that as long as you're able to draw this tree diagram, you can spice it out. You can clearly find out every possible case. Then Bayes formula is there. You don't have to memorize that. So that is this example. It's a very simple example. It may not be that example. Not that simple. I'm sorry for that. So it's also the solution is all there. Of course, you can use Bayes formula directly. So any questions? I think for the exam, I don't care whether you use a tree diagram or whatever formula. So I think the only thing important is that you need to maybe understand what you're doing. You can either draw a tree diagram or say, by Bayes' formula, we can have this. It's fine. As long as your final result makes sense, you will have the full mark. So you don't have to draw a tree diagram. Any other questions? So, okay. So let's see another example. So this example, actually is it's very similar to the previous one. But I like this example very much. So, the story is like this. So suppose there is a rare disease. So only 1 in 1,000 adults have this rare disease. And for this disease, we have a test for that. So this test actually is a pretty good test. So when an individual has this disease, a positive test result will occur 99% of the time. So which means that if I'm a patient, I have this disease, then I have the test. 99% of the time, I will see positive results. It's pretty accurate because 99, very close to 1, right? And for an individual without the disease, so the probability that it will have a positive result would be 2%. The probability is 2%. So this is also a good number. So So that's 2% is the so-called false positive. So the probability of false positive is 2%. I don't have this disease, but I will have a positive result. The chance of that is only 2%, right? So this is because this is a false positive or just a false alarm, definitely. So the probability of that need to be reduced. It would be great if it's as close as to zero, right? 2% is a small number. It shows that it's great. And the question is like this. If a randomly selected individual is tested and the result is positive, what is the probability that the individual has the disease? So this is this question. So let's go over the solution. So the solution is here. Again, we need to define events, right? So we define event A, so which means a randomly selected person has the disease. Because we know that this disease is a rare disease, so the probability of that is just 0.1%, a small number, right? And then there's another event, so which means that so this person has a positive test result. So we don't know the probability of that, but we know certain conditional probability about this event. If the person has the disease, we know that with 99% probability, so the result will be positive. So P of B given A is 99%. And also, if this person does not have the disease, so the positive probability is just 2%. That's probability of false positive, 2%, right? Then the question is, if this guy has a positive result, what will be the probability that this guy has the disease, right? So we just do that in a routine way. Draw a tree diagram first, right? So from the root node, we just consider whether this guy has the disease or not, right? If A occurs, which means that we have 0.1% of chance this guy has a disease. So that's the first branch. If this guy has the disease, then 99% of time, the test will be positive. So it is here, right? So then, next, at the node, what will be the probability that this guy both has the disease and a positive result? Just 0.1% times 99%, right? So that's the first case. The second case means that this guy has the disease, but the test result is negative. So then we have so this number. And let's see the second branch from the root node, so which means that this guy actually does not have the disease. So then what is the probability? So 99.9%, right? And if this guy does not have the disease, the probability of false positive is 2%, is here, right? So then we have the probability of the third case. And for the fourth case, which means that so this guy does not have a disease, and given that he has a negative test result, right? It is 99.9 times 98%. So you can see that this number will be very, very, very close to 98%, right? And also, we know that because all those four cases are all possible cases. So if we add those four probabilities, we will have one, right? So then we wish to know what is the probability of A given B. Probability of A given B, so we just follow the definition of conditional probability, right? In the numerator, so probability of A intersect B, it is the first term colored in blue, right? And in the numerator, we wish to know the probability of B. How can we calculate that? We just pick up all cases would be there, right? Just so this term, the third case, the first case plus the third case, then we have this number, right? Then we just calculate that. So the first number divided by the sum of the first one and third one, it turns out that it's 4.7%, right? Nothing new, right? But for this problem, actually, if you think of this a bit more, you may realize that so this number may seem too small, right? Actually, if we go back to the statement of this problem, so as I explained, if you have the disease, 99% of chance, the result will be positive. That is a good number, very good number, right? Very close to one. And the probability of a false positive is also good. Close to zero, only 2%, right? So which means that actually this test is pretty good. Whether you consider it this way or that way is good, right? But it turns out that, so for a randomly selected person, so if this guy has positive test result, then the chance that this guy has the disease would be less than 5%. What does it mean? It means that you have a very accurate test, but it may not be that useful, right? And actually, so maybe I can share my own experience, because you may realize how good those two numbers would be. Say, actually, my wife was infected with COVID in February. So before that, my son had symptoms. So my son coughed, muscle ache, low fever, runny nose, whatever. Very, very typical for quite a few days. But when he had ART test, always negative. So after several days, my wife had the same symptoms. And after she had fever for 3 days or something, so her ART test appeared positive. But throughout the period, maybe for 2 weeks or 10 days something, my son's ART result was always negative. But from this, I think probably the ART test may not be even very accurate, right? Because my son and my wife had the same symptoms for, you know, a period overlapped. My wife tested positive, but my son always negative. So it seems that something wrong, right? So actually, if you check the news or whatever, and it says that for the ART test, I think the number is far below this 99%. It could be 70% someday. But I don't know, right? So here you see that this one, at least in this example, those two numbers are great. But why, with such a great numbers, though this test appeared not so useful? What happened, right? So we need to explain this. So how to explain this? Of course, so we got a number less than 5%. We need to check where this number is from, right? So this number is this numerator divided by this denominator. So where is this numerator? This numerator is here. It is this, the first case, right? So this number is the product of this 0.1% and this 99%. It is said this 99% is a great number, very close to 1, right? So this number divided by the denominator. So where is the denominator? Denominator is the sum of the first number and the third number, right? So now you see that the final number is less than 5% because the numerator is too small and the denominator is big and not that small. But then the next question is why the denominator is not that small, right? So of course, denominator is the first thing plus the third thing. So now it seems that the third thing could be a bit too big, right? So what is the third number? It is this number, probability of a complement times, so that's 2%. As I said, this 2% is also a good number because it is the probability of false positive. We wish this number to be close to 0. 2% is not bad, at least, right? However, so the third number is still relatively big as compared with the first one. What happened? So I believe that now we can see where the problem is. Because although, so this 2% is a small number, but if we compare this number with this 0.1%, it is still too big, right? 0.1% is just if we use this 0.1% divided by this 2%, what do you have? That's 0.05. That's 0.5%, right? The final number, this number, actually is close to 5%, right? What happened? Now you can see that. So even if this 2% is a small number, because this disease is a rare disease, so that 0.1% is still much, much smaller than 2%. As a result, it will make this probability much, much less than 1. So the result is that if the disease is rare, even if you have a very accurate or powerful test, and when you test a randomly selected person, it may not be useful at all, right? So at first glance, it could be a bit counterintuitive, but if you plug those numbers there, I believe you can see that. The issue is, so this number colored in blue is too small. as compared with this number colored in blue, right? Even if, so those are two small numbers. But as long as, so this number is extremely small, then the test may not be that useful, right? So then, so of course, that explains why it happened. But you may ask me the question, so if such a test, such a powerful test, may not be that useful, then what can we do, right? How can we test such a rare disease? That's the question, right? You have a powerful test, but for rare disease, is that useful? If it's not that useful, how can we make it useful, right? And actually, for rare disease, I think people would like to do in practice is something like this. We cannot just rely on a single test to identify a rare disease. It must be combined with other evidence. So the point is we must use other evidence to identify people who are potentially a patient. So that we will try to make this probability much bigger than just a 0.1%. If we can successfully make this happen, then such a test could become useful again. So maybe let me plug in some numbers here, and I believe you can see. So suppose that for this example, for this rare disease, so if a person has this disease, he or she must also have low fever, so which is a symptom of this rare disease. So if this guy does not have a fever at all, then we can simply rule him out, so he will not have this disease. Right? You don't have to have this test. So in this way, if we can identify such a symptom, then before we do this medical test, actually we only need to consider people with low fever. Right? So in this case, actually, we should not consider everybody. We only consider people with low fever. In other words, we just shrink the sample space. We make the sample space much smaller. So let's suppose that the 1% of all people have low fever. So, and for this test, only if you have low fever can you have this test. Let's see, with this number, what will happen? So first, because now we only consider people who have low fever. And in this case, the probability that, so the guy who has low fever also has this rare disease would be changed, right? So among all people, that's 0.1%. Because only 1% of people will have low fever, then within this sample space, the probability of A would change, right? Would be 0.1% over 1%, would be 10%. Among all people who have low fever, 10% of them will have this disease, right? So let's plug in this number into the problem. So it's essentially we just change this 0.1% into 10%. Let's see what will happen. Actually, we just what do we need to do? Just change this number. Everything else will be the same, right? So then, 0.1 now becomes 10. Then, in the first case, so the probability will be like this. In the third case, will be like this. So if we plug in those two numbers into our formula, it turns out that it's So the result that, so this guy has the disease given that he has low fever and the positive test result. So that probability will be nearly 85%. You see that it's much, much bigger than 5%, right? So you see, with this, then the test result will be useful again, right? So this is the solution to this example. Questions? Yeah. Just a random number I put there. So for example, low fever means your body temperature is below whatever threshold, right? We can just test. Maybe if we randomly pick 100,000 people and test them and monitor their body temperature regularly, and you'll see. And also, I think in our days, it could be very simple because, so for example, I have this tracker, right? As long as I keep it here every night, so it will report on my body temperature. And I believe, so that number would be reported to the watch company. I may just check with the watch company to know this 1%, right? So other questions? Okay, so this is that example. Now, next we will discuss independence between two events. So will be independence. So maybe let's consider two events, A and B. So we just studied conditional probability, and we know that in general, when you know B occurs, so that piece of information will change the probability that A occurs, right? Why is so? As we explained for several times, the unconditional probability of A will be changed into the conditional probability of A given B, right? But it's possible that B has nothing to do with A. So, as I explained, I think before the break, when I discussed the example of flip a coin twice, right? So it's possible that B has nothing to do with A. So which means that after you know B, the probability that A occurs will not change. So conditional probability is still equal to unconditional probability. So it's just like something like this. So you told someone something, right? So you have a conversation with a person. You told him something. After that, he just replied, "Who cares?" Right? Something like this. So who cares means your information would change nothing, right? So this notion is called independence. So what is the formal definition of independence between two events? Actually, it's pretty straightforward. Two events, A and B, are said to be independent if the conditional probability of A given B is equal to the unconditional probability of A. So in this case, it's said, those two events are said to be independent, right? So like I said, it's just who cares, right? And actually, maybe we can think of this definition a little bit. So if A and B are independent, then what will be the probability of their intersection? So the probability of A intersecting B by the multiplication rule should be equal to the probability of A given B times the probability of B, right? But if they're independent, then this conditional probability is equal to the unconditional probability. So in this case, you can see that the probability of A intersect B should be equal to the probability of A times probability of B, right? You have the independence, you should have this result. And also, conversely, so suppose you have this result, the probability of the intersection is equal to the product, then let's see what will happen. If we consider the conditional probability, A given B, so by definition, it should be like this, right? So in the numerator is the probability of the intersection. And for the numerator, because we already have this condition, so the probability of intersection is equal to the product. So then the numerator turns out to be like this. Denominator is the probability of B, and you can see that so the probability of B in the numerator can be canceled out so with the denominator. So in the end, you will have the probability of A on the right-hand side of this equation. So what does it mean? It means that if you have this condition, what condition? Condition that the probability of the intersection is equal to the product, then conditional probability should be equal to the unconditional probability. So which means that A and B should be independent, right? So you see, here, actually, if they're independent, then probability of intersection should be equal to the product. And if the probability of the intersection is equal to the product, then those two events should be independent, right? So now we can see that actually, so this condition, the probability of intersection equal to the probability of intersection is equal to product, actually it's just an equivalent condition of the definition. So because it's equivalent, and actually you can use it as the definition instead. It's the same because it's the same as the definition. So then actually, so if you have check other textbooks, probability textbooks, I think in my impression, maybe half of them would like to use this as the definition. And half of them would like to use this as the definition. So if you check, you know, again, the definition of the independence of two events in different books, you may find out different definitions. But they're equivalent. They're the same thing. So then you ask me the question, why some people prefer to use the first one, some people would like to prefer to use the second one. Because they have their respective merits. I personally would like to use the first one because the meaning of that, the intuitive meaning of that is very clear, right? As I said, the meaning of that is after you know that B occurs, it won't have to know more about A, right? It has nothing to do with each other. So it just said conditional probability is equal to unconditional probability. So that actual piece of information would change nothing. So intuitively, that's great. But why people would like to use this, sometimes would like to use this as definition. Because if you observe that, you can see that actually, so here, the position of A and B actually is symmetric, right? You change the position of A and B, it's still the same. What does it mean? It means that if A is independent of B, B must also be independent of A, right? So from the first definition, actually, you may not be able to see it immediately. But from here, you can easily see that. So independence must be mutually. A and B are independent. You can also say B and A are independent. It will be the same thing, right? I think that's a... So that's why I think a lot of people like this better. But again, so because for you to better understand the conception of independence, I prefer this better, but it will be the same thing, right? So, I think this is independence, and here is an example. I think this example is very simple. Maybe I just give it to you. And also, there's a proposition of independence. So it says that if you have two independent events, A and B, then you can prove that A and B complement are also independent. Right? So this is this is the proposition. I think I may not have time to finish the proof of that, so maybe I just leave it to next week. So before I finish, any questions, comments? If no questions, I think you're free to leave, and see you next week. Thank you.